If you cannot see my smiling face, I welcome you, just invite you to move towards the front where you can see. It's my privilege today to, our privilege, to see the gospel, not just hear it, but see it, as Mike Eklund comes to be baptized. And you've witnessed baptisms before. There's no saving grace in the water here. This is water from the Elko water treatment plant, okay? So it's not holy water. And there are no healing qualities in it. But it is symbolic of something very, very special. We baptize not because we're Baptists. We baptize because, well, Jesus told us to make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we see throughout Scripture where the disciples who received that commission from Jesus also baptized. Peter is used by God in a huge and tremendous way. In Acts chapter 2, he preaches this sermon. People are convicted of their sins. What must we do to be saved? He says, repent and be baptized. The Ethiopian court official, Candace from Ethiopia, Acts chapter 8, meets Philip. Philip preaches to him about Jesus from Isaiah. Somewhere in the course of that conversation, Philip mentions being baptized because this Ethiopian says, look, water, what prevents me from being baptized? So we see throughout the book of Acts and other places where baptism is an important first step. It's not a box to check, but a step to follow, a step to take. And of all the things that Jesus asks us to do as disciples, getting wet is probably the easiest. When you think about it, I mean, Mike's kind of nervous this morning, but there are going to be a whole bunch of other things that God asks Mike to do that are going to be a little bit more difficult than just getting wet. So, Mike, I'm going to have you come down now, if you would. It's very warm. All right. Let me read Mike's testimony. Real quick. Mike writes, when I was young, my Uncle Mike used to give me these little Christian comic books. Probably the Chick comic books. Do you remember the Chick comic books, anybody? I always liked the comics, and I thought they were cool. I honestly don't remember what they were about now, but I remember at the end of all of them, they would tell you that you can't go to heaven just by being a good person. That the only way was through accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior and asking Him into your heart. So I did as a young boy. And I didn't know that I only needed to do it once, so I did it probably 10 or 15 times. You're not alone, Mike. You're not alone. My Uncle Mike is no longer with us, but he made a big impact on my life and the lives of so many others. That's just a small tip of the iceberg of Mike's testimony. And I hope that after the service, you'll make a point to shake Mike's hand and get to know him a little bit better. He and his wife, Lynette, right there on the front row with family. It's not just a box to check, as I said, but a step to take. And he's publicly acknowledging today that he's died to an old life and been raised to a new. That's really what baptism is all about. It's an outward expression of an internal reality. Just as Jesus was buried in the grave and raised 3 days later, I'm going to bury Mike in the water for just a few seconds and then raise him up. And it's a picture that what happened to Jesus has happened to us. We've died to an old life and been raised to a new one. So Mike, let me ask you, are you trusting in Jesus Christ alone as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right, I'm going to take this headset off. for obvious reasons. Because of your profession of faith in Christ, Mike. Please take a moment to visit. Moment to visit with Mike after the service. And, you know, maybe as you saw this, you thought, I've never gotten wet before. I've never followed Christ in believer's baptism. And there is an order. We trust Christ as our Savior, and then we're baptized. It's not the other way around. Again, there's no saving grace in this water. It's a symbol that Mike's no longer the person he used to be because of Jesus. And if you've never experienced believer's baptism, maybe we need to have a conversation, and we can set that up. Let's pray. Father, thank you for Mike, for Lynette, his family. For Riley, for all of the family who are here today and others who couldn't be, for the way that you're at work in his life. Thank you, Jesus, that you make us new. You change us from the inside out. And we pray that you would continue to encourage Mike in his walk with you, individually, one-on-one, through your Spirit, but also through us as his new church family. Help him to know that he's not alone, that he doesn't have to face things far greater than getting wet alone, that when those tough times come, he's got brothers, Lynette's got sisters that they can lean on. Father, thank you for this time of worship and even more testimonies to come. We pray that you would guide us. We want to see you, Jesus. We want to see you. So come, make your presence known. We ask, Father, in Jesus' name, amen. And greet one another for a couple of minutes.
Them high, you choose the weak and make them strong. You heal our brokenness inside and give us life. The same love that set the captives free, the same love that opened eyes to see is calling us. us all by name. You are calling us all by name. Same God that spread the heavens wide, same God that was crucified, is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. You take the faithless one aside and speak the words, you are mine. You call the cynic and the proud. Come to me now. The same love that set the captives free, the same love that opened eyes to see, is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. Spread the heavens wide, the same God that was crucified is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. You take the faithless one aside and speak the words, you are mine. You call the cynic and the proud. Come to me now. The same love that set the captives free, the same love that opened eyes to see, is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. The same God that spread the heavens wide, the same God that was crucified, is calling us all. Calling us all by name. Ooh, 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 ooh. You're calling, you're calling, you're calling us to the cross. You're calling, you're calling, you're calling us to the cross.
Risen.
Jesus, you are Lord of all. No beginning and no end, you're my hope and my defense. You came to seek and save the lost. You paid it all on the cross. You are stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me, it is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher. Stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me, it is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all. You are stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me. Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all.
Amen. I just feel like we need to give the Lord a clap offering.
Praise the Lord.
Because he is stronger. Amen. And he has saved us. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Jesus. shine on us. Let your face shine on us. There is no one like you. There is no one like you, God. All my hope is in you, Jesus, 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 Jesus.
Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you for your kindness that leads us to repentance. Father, we thank you for your unending mercy and unending grace. Lord, your word says that your mercies are new every morning. They never run out. Thank you. Thank you for that unending grace that continues to flow no matter what we do, no matter how far we roam. You're right there, pursuing us, calling us. Thank you, Lord. Father, I thank you that we get to hear this morning how you've pursued two of us, Lord. They're going to share their story with you. So, Lord, I pray that you would strengthen them. Father, that you would speak to our hearts as we listen. And, Lord, we love you. We thank you, Lord, that when we're met, when two or three of us are gathered in your name, that you are enthroned in our praises. You are right here with us. So, Lord, speak. We are listening. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
There are moments in a song where the crescendo builds and you're not sure whether to get on your face and cry or dance or run. And there have been times in my Baptist heritage when I just wanted to run through the auditorium because my heart was so full of Jesus' joy. And it's a privilege to be with you today, to be family, to witness Mike's baptism, to hear these testimonies. But the greatest joy is to be in his presence, to know that we know that we know that he loves us. Whether the crescendo leads to getting on our face and just weeping out of a grateful heart that he loves us and he saved us, or running, and that may sound strange to you. Sometimes the energy and the excitement that Holy Spirit puts on you and in you is such that you just get so excited you want to run and yell to the top of your lungs, Jesus loves me. He loves me. He loves me. He loves me. He loves me. However you say it. Well, whether that's your experience or not today, pray that by the end of this service, you'll leave having had an encounter with Jesus. What binds us together as a church, what unites us is what divides us, right? You've heard me say that before. What unites us is what divides us. So we want to make sure as a church body that what unites us is the most important thing. In fact, it stays with us even after we take our final breath. And what unites us is not the kind of vehicle we drive or the jobs that we have or whether we were raised in California or Nevada or Utah or Massachusetts or Pennsylvania. What unites us is not the color of our skin. What unites us is not our educational background. What unites us is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. He has got to be the main thing. And we can't say that too much around here. We don't want to say that. We can never say that too much. We don't want to stop saying it, that what unites us is Jesus Christ. So we need to hear one another say that from time to time. We need to hear our testimonies. And as you've heard me say also before, this is not a one-man show. We have several other elders, but we also have a congregation full of people who know Jesus and have a personal testimony. They've had an experience, an encounter with Jesus. And so we want to hear from two today who have experienced that relationship with Jesus. The first is Beth. Beth, come and share your story with us. And then following Beth, Tony. Is it on?
Can you hear me? Okay, good. Yay. Okay. The reason I'm excited to share about this is because of what I've learned over the last 2 years. I believe some people could shorten their pain if they would learn to sit in the initial pain. For example, people who go through trauma, people who go through seasons of hard relationships, instead of sitting in the pain, they build a wall to protect themselves from the pain. They protect themselves from what they believe hurts them. Instead of feeling what is really painful, and then seeing something beautiful that comes from that, they protect themselves, becoming numb to it. I know, though, that if you sit in the pain, you will come out on the other side. Myself, years ago, I didn't sit through the pain. I've always been a person that would become numb to the pain. I had eventually learned to come out on the other side. I needed to sit in the pain in order to heal. So I have a story that changed me. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Beth. Because of my pain, because of all this mess, I am fully changed. I am transformed. I see life differently. I'm a better wife because of it. My kids have a different mom. My friends have a different friend because of the way I was transformed through. My friends have a different friend because of the way I was transformed through the pain of losing everything. It took losing who I was and getting down to the lowest pits of my despair. It took putting away my anger and my bitterness towards Christians to be where I am today. Before I married the love of my life, I had been married once before. While married, I joined a small group that was for married couples. I felt safe here. I felt at home. I built friendships that became so strong, I saw them as family. My husband at the time was an alcoholic. It got to the point where when cleaning, I found 63 Jaeger, bottles of Jaeger in hidden places. He also used meth frequently. No matter how hard I tried to tell him I loved him, he would tell me to stop, and he was tired of hearing it. He refused to hold my hand or sleep in the same bed. I had tried to get counseling, but he refused. I tried to get him into some sort of rehabilitation, but he refused. On a trip to Seattle, while my one-year-old and I slept, he snuck out of the hotel. When the morning came, after many hours of not knowing where he was, I received a call from a police officer that he was in jail for second-degree assault. It was that day I realized I wasn't angry, I was just done. I was tired and I felt alone. My friendships at church continued to thrive and grow stronger through the years. They were the one thing that held me together. Church was the one thing that made me excited for my day-to-day life. But here comes the part of my story where all that pain began, where my life changed. My current husband, Chris, and I did not start a relationship as most couples do. We met through Bible study years before, and once I found out he was going through a divorce, I called him up to talk to him about it. He was the only one I knew that would be able to understand what I was going through. We talked for a while, and I invited him over. I made some soup, and we just talked about everything that was going on. And as he was mourning the loss of his old life, I had invited him over to watch some shows that would help him laugh. I think talking made us both feel better about everything that we were going through, and that is all we did. As months went by, my own divorce was up at the beginning process. My then husband did not care if I started seeing other people. He told me to just do whatever. However, while this all was going on, rumors started that we were having an affair. I agree that we should have not been hanging out, but we were two very broken people going through very similar things. But because of those rumors that were being spread, my friends stopped talking to me. It was very apparent I was alone more now than ever. Soon after, I left my marriage and moved in with a girlfriend. During this time, the gossip did not cease. It just got much worse. I had heard words being said. At one point, two ladies from church called me a whore. Another woman came up to me, my girlfriend I was living with, and told her something I will not repeat here, but it was bad. People started attacking me on Facebook, people I did not know. I had private messages telling me that I should go kill myself. Several women came up to the friend I was living with and asked for all the juicy details. I did not know these women. I was told Chloe should be taken away from me, that I did not deserve her. Guys, let me tell you this. I wept. I wept over and over. It was over the loss of my friends, whom I considered family, and the loss of my church that held me whole. Christians are not supposed to treat you like that. Or so I thought, and I walked away from God. I walked away from everything I knew. But eventually, it did lead to that, an affair. I thought long and hard about how I should tell you guys what eventually happened, but there is no way to move over sin, because it's such a huge part of my story, how it shaped me, how God is going to use me. When you are so broken and you have been pushed to the brink of the cliff, you will eventually jump off of it. After many months of my relationship with my now husband, I got pregnant. And after a couple of months, I began to have a miscarriage. I wondered if God was punishing me for what I had done. After my miscarriage, rumors got worse. I was told that I deserved to lose my baby. There was another rumor that I had an abortion. My depression continued to get worse, but my current husband was the one thing keeping me together. Now fast forward to 2 years ago. Chris and I were married for 3 years at the time. We gave our life back to God, and change began to happen. We started going back to Calvary. New faces, new people. God drew me back. I started the worship team, and little by little, God changed me. I built new friendships. My relationship with God grew stronger than it ever had before. I realized it took losing myself. I lost who I was because I had to be made new. Looking back, God had a plan. He was reforming me. He was making me someone new, someone stronger, wiser, and bolder for God than I ever was before. Now, I have a story to tell of brokenness, depression, and deep despair. God was creating who I was during my darkest hours because he was ready for me to become a different person. Now, isn't that the story of our life? Now, if you are a believer, then you know Scripture says we are literally called to be constantly renewed. I can look at my life and realize that God had a plan this entire time. I can see so clearly how God has taken a very crazy season and has remade me a new woman. And I'm all the better for it. I am a better version of myself than I ever was. 1.1 Beth was a different person with lots of friends, but was completely broken on the inside. But Beth 2.0 is a mom of 5 beautiful children, has a wonderful and amazing marriage, and is strong spiritually. 2 people that pray together on a regular basis. And 2 people that constantly build each other up. None of this would have been if God had not created a clean and new me. Now I am a woman of God, a woman with a story, and who is now loved more than I ever was before. My marriage is strong, beautiful, and a story to tell others of who Jesus is. He is a God for the broken, not for the perfect. He did not come to die for us because we were good people, but because we were broken. If you are here today with a similar story, you are not alone. If someone in the church has hurt you, you are not alone. If you have had an affair, you are not alone. If you struggle with depression, you are not alone. No matter how deep your valley is, God can change you. He can renew you, and every sin will be washed away, white as snow. He is a God of mercy, love, of compassion, and if you know anyone struggling, be there for that person. It just takes one person to love on someone so broken and help them put back together by showing who Jesus is and how much he loves them. The church is a place of broken people because if we were not broken, we wouldn't be here. Now, Tony, your turn. Thank you.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Mike, proud to call you brother. Thank you, Beth. It's just such an honor to know you and Chris. So anyways, for those of you who don't know me, my name's Tony Evans. You know, I was born in 1969 back in Detroit, and my parents were Vic and Leona. Dad was Catholic, mom was Mormon. I was raised Catholic, and for all intents and purposes, my childhood was it was pretty normal. I had 3 older brothers that picked on me, and subjected me to all kinds of torment. And I'm really, truly lucky that I survived that, you know. So anyways, and when I was 7, we moved down to Ohio. 8 years old, you know, me and my brothers were back in the woods smoking cigarettes, doing things that we wouldn't have done, like out in front of our house, you know. And then 10 years old, I got introduced to marijuana. And shortly after that, alcohol came into the picture. You know, as a kid growing up, it was back in the 70s, it was pretty normal to fetch beers for dad. You know, and I love popping the top off the beers. And as the reward, dad, can I have a sip of your beer? And he would let me have a sip of his beer, and I'd try and drink the whole thing. You know, I just love, I don't know. So anyways, fast forwarding to about 19, I almost died in a drunken car wreck with my brother, and almost killed both of us. Fortunately, then we put our seatbelts on. You know, at that time we didn't have to. So at that time, I asked for help. I asked to get checked into a psychiatric hospital for drug and alcohol abuse. And that would be the third time at 19 years old that I was institutionalized for drug and alcohol abuse. And I found recovery, and I got very involved in recovery, and spent the next almost 8 years of my life involved with recovery. And then about 26, my incredibly intelligent brain told me that, well, maybe you could go back and drink, and maybe it was just all the drugs you were taking, you know, as a kid. And so I went, I started drinking again, and the next, I think 7-8 years of my life, I went to the darkest hole I'd ever been in my entire life. And at 34 years old, I wound up getting back involved with recovery, and it was a long process. And so November 16th, 2004, was my sober date, and I'm now sober 18 years. So thank you. So even though I got sober, I still, you know, as part of recovery, you're supposed to be spiritual and live and pray and do stuff like that. And they talk about God of your own understanding. And I moved out to Elko in 2010 from Michigan, and I just kind of wasn't feeling it. You know, I wasn't feeling the whole spiritual, and the literature says that, you know, if we're to remain sober, we need to grow spiritually. So I started kind of checking around at some churches, and one kind of was weird, and it fell apart. It was like a science of the mind thing. I can't remember the whole story there. At any rate, I wound up checking into a Christian church, non-denominational, and so that church was really great about bringing in outside teachers. You know, like once every couple of few months, they would have amazing teachers come in, and one of the teachers was Dr. Kendall, and he taught about the geography of the Bible. And I still, at this point, I didn't confess, you know, with my mouth, that I was a believer, and so I walked away from that Sunday, and my brain went, wow, that's like the geography in the Bible is 98% accurate. And at the time, I thought it was myself, but I know now that this was the Holy Spirit talking to me, you know, like kind of giving me some jabs, you know. And so I had some time to think about this and meditate on this. So my brain or Holy Spirit told me, if the geography is 98% accurate and we can go to those places today, why wouldn't the rest of this book be 100% accurate? Why wouldn't this be the word of the Lord? And it was at that point that I said, wow, I think I'm a believer. So the next Sunday at church, after service, I went and I told our pastor, and this is a different church still I was going to, and so my friend Tony was the worship leader, and Tony and I were developing this friendship, and he would always just talk about the word, man. He was just always had something to say out of the Bible, and I loved it, And so anyways, after service, I went up to the front and I told him, I said, hey, I believe Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. And so I had the pastor on one side of me, and Tony was on the other side of me, and they're praying. And they're praying, and they're asking me these questions, you know, do you believe, do you accept, you know, do you believe Jesus died on the cross for you? And I was like, yes, 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 emphatically, yes. And from that point on, I just, it was like I was washed, you know. And still, I'm a slow learner and a fast forgetter. And it takes me a long time to really process things. My brain's very analytical. So anyways, we went to a men's retreat that our church had, and so Tony played guitar, I played guitar. And I was like, hey, you know, maybe we can peel off, you know, and play guitar and maybe read out of the Bible or talk about some stuff, you know, at the retreat. And he goes, yeah, bring your guitar. And I was like, okay, cool. And so when we got there, everybody was, you know, out there. We had dinner, and I was like, hey, I brought my guitar. He's like, cool. And so it was time for our first study Friday night. He goes, hey, go get your guitar. And I said, oh. I was like, I didn't really understand, but I was like, okay, because we were going for study. And so I get my guitar, and I'm standing there, and he hands me a sheet of music like we use with all these chords on it, and I'd never done read, you know, I've never played and read off a sheet music before. And I was like, what am I supposed to do with this? And so in like 30 seconds, he gave me the Reader's Digest version of worship chords. And I was like, oh, okay, yeah, I got you. And so that whole weekend, I got to play with my buddy and another really good friend, Josh. We got to play this worship music. And I felt like the Lord was... I felt like I was being called, you know, and it took me a little while to ask, you know, just to ask if I could, you know, join the praise team there, the worship team, and so I got to practice with them, and I did the sound like these guys are doing back there, every Sunday for services and every Wednesday for services, and I played, you know, during our rehearsals, And I just really felt this was drawing me to the Lord. You know, this was part of what was becoming my walk with the Lord. And so some things happened, and I wound up here. And I talked to the previous worship leader, and I got on here, and I started playing here. You know, this is before Daryl and Deanna came, and I just really felt like this was. You know, this is just, I mean, it's amazing to do this because I get to help you guys worship the Lord. You know, and it's such an honor, you know, in the grace and the mercy that I feel from that. So fast forwarding a couple years now, I think it was 2019, I lost my father, and in 2019, I lost a job, and then I think it was moving forward a couple more years, I lost another job, I lost my mother, through some of this stuff, my oldest daughter said that she doesn't want to talk to me, everything that's wrong in her life is all my fault, and so I lost that. And my younger daughter, she is like in the world, you know, she's living in this weirdness that's going on in the world. And I really felt this sense of loss and pain, and I was carrying these burdens, and I didn't know what to do with them, you know, and I just kept praying and kept praying. And my wife and I decided that we were going to separate, that was in 21 also. And we separated. We still lived together, but we were like distant roommates. And then around that time is when Daryl came. And So the first Sunday that Daryl preached here, I was sitting where I usually sit, and I was in tears because I was in all this pain. And after we went downstairs and we had our little luncheon, and I waited for everybody talking to Daryl, you know, to kind of die out, and everybody kind of left. And I told him, he said, have you been looking in my window? And he looked at me like, and I just spewed all over him. I let it all out. Deanna was standing there too. And I told him I was transparent. You know, this is where I'm at. I'm getting divorced and I've got all this loss. And praise the Lord, Daryl got me connected with a counselor that helped me walk through all this grief I was dealing with. Within 10 minutes, he said, he goes, you have a lot of compounded grief that you haven't really dealt with, don't you think? And I said, yeah. And so at any rate, we spent, I don't know, 5, 6, 8 months going through all that, and I met with him once a week or once every other week. And this is, you know, this is how the Lord just continues to work in my life, because I could have turned tail and run, you know, with all this pain. I could have dove back into a bottle. I could have hid, you know, but I heard there's a verse somewhere in the Bible where it says that it's the Lord's job to rebuke the evil, but it's our job to stand there in the middle of it and let him do what he has to do. And that's what I've been doing. And as a result of playing here for worship and our Bible studies, I'm involved with, excuse me, with two small groups. You know, this just continues to draw me to the Lord. And just recently, I watched a couple of studies on the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit came and talked to me again. And he said, you need to honor the Lord. Your actions need to honor the Lord. What you see needs to honor the Lord. What you hear needs to honor the Lord. And I was like, I was just overwhelmed, and I felt like I was floating. You know, this feel, I've kind of felt it before when I first got sober. They call it a pink cloud, you know, and I just, it just continued to strengthen my walk with the Lord. So some verses that have been, was really helpful for me during this period, and I'm still kind of in it, but it's, you know, it's just, I've had more peace and more clarity and more happiness and more joy over the last 6 months of my life. And that's the Lord working in my life, you know, because I want to fall into the misery and depression and the guilt, the shame, the remorse. And so I came across this because I had to get to a point where I had to accept the fact that I might have to lose everything and start over again. And I became okay with that because of this verse, Hebrews 13:6, it says, so we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? I read that, and I just was like, that's right. Unless somebody shows up with a pistol and puts one in me, you know, what can humans do to me? You know, and we talked about this this morning in our small group. You know, once we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, the Lord seals us. He marks us. I have an ID mark from the Lord. You know, and I know He knows me because nobody else has the same fingerprints on this planet. So He marked me as His own. The first verse I ever learned was Psalms 103, verse 8. But I think this is kind of a derivative. It came out of a verse from Exodus 34, verse 6. But I'm going to read the psalm because it goes a little quicker. So it's Psalm 103, verse 8. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in mercy. This is the first verse that I ever memorized. And I was like so proud of it, you know. I was like, yes. And I make it just, you know, just abounding in mercy. Every morning, you know, we are poured on with grace, mercy, and forgiveness. And then I can't remember when, but I heard this verse out of Hebrew, and it blew my mind. So it is Hebrews 8, verse 12, for I will be merciful to their unrighteousness and their sins and their lawless deeds, I will remember no more. And so when we were studying that, it was like, you know, not only do I get this grace and mercy and forgiveness, but he won't remember it anymore. He forgets about it. So why do I have to hang on to it? I need to let it go and forget about it too. So the last thing I wanted to share with you is growing up in the Catholic school and Catholic church. You know, a friend of mine shared with me not that long ago that he had a great experience in the Catholic church, and I didn't have a terrible experience. It didn't click. But we're in John 1, not only for our Sunday services, but my small group, we're in 1 John. And my goodness, just the love that John talks about in this is just, it's so overwhelming. And if you can't tell, I get a little emotional. But growing up in the Catholic school and Catholic church, I never heard about this love that God has for me, you know. And so studying 1 John, it's just, I love it so much because, you know, not only does the Lord love me, but he loves me no matter what. And he's not sitting there wagging his finger at me like, you shoulda. He's not condemning me. He's there with his arms wide open, you know. And I'm so thankful and grateful for my church family. I feel like, and I was just sharing with somebody, I think it was Paul the other day, that I just feel like the people that are here are so real, you know, and so genuine. And we don't have this happy church face on, you know. We're not, everything's fine, it's great, you know. I sat back there in so much pain and cried on Sundays. And man, it's okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Beth, Tony. Yeah, church is supposed to be a healing place for a hurting world. It's not a place where we put on masks and pretend that everything is okay when it's not. Because some Sundays it's not okay. And it's a dark pit. And hopelessness and despair are more real than any kind of joy we read about in the Bible or hear from somebody else. And maybe that's your story this morning as you hear Beth and Tony talk. It's like, well, that's not happened to me. Or I wish Jesus would meet me like that. Are they special? Has Jesus forgotten about me? No, the very fact that you're here hearing their story or watching online means that Father knows your fingerprint, as Tony talked about. He knows you. If he knows when a sparrow falls to the ground, if he knows how many hairs on your head, he knows what you're going through right now. So often in my life, it's just been a matter of bringing my pain to him. I think that's the challenge for most of us, is that we want to try to deal with our pain in our own strength. We look to other things in life to be a salve. We look for other things in life to rescue us. When all along, Jesus is putting us in a place where the only way out is up, and the only way out is in him. He loves you, and he's got his finger on your life today. As I said, what unites us is what divides us. And what unites us is a personal relationship with Jesus. And every so often, we celebrate that unique relationship we have with Jesus through something called the Lord's Supper, where we take bread and juice. And in some baskets back here, there are these little packets. If you've not received, if you've not picked up one, we've got some guys who will pass them out now. If you just raise your hand, if you don't have bread or juice, and we'll make sure you get one before we take that. Guys, several over here as well. If you know Christ is your Savior this morning, then we invite you to participate with us in this experience. It's not just about being a member of Calvary, but if you know Jesus as your Savior. And as we take the bread and the juice, it's so easy for us sometimes to turn this into a ritual and make it something like a box we check. And we all fall into that at times. I fall into that at times. And so we want to make sure that as we do this, we're diving into something Jesus, a real person, did for us 2,000 years ago. And what he did then continues to make a difference in our lives today. He is present with us while we take the bread and the juice. And even though we're not taking it just like the first century disciples did, you know, we don't have this long table, if you've seen pictures of the Lord's Supper, and we're not leaning on Jesus' breast as John did. We're not seated around the table doing the Passover meal, so to speak. This can be just as significant, because in our minds and our hearts, we're thinking about the fact that someone, but not just anyone, God, stepped into time and space, became flesh and blood, and sacrificed his body for us. He really died. As Tony said, if 98% of the geography of the Bible is true, why not go 100% and say it's all true? And it is all true. A man named Jesus of Nazareth actually walked this earth, claimed to be more than just a rabbi, more than just a teacher, claimed to be the Messiah, the Son of God. And he said for those who would follow after him, if you take my body and drink my blood, symbolic of taking him into our lives, we would not experience eternal death. And so as we take the bread today, we are reminding ourselves of something that happened in time and space 2,000 years ago. We're also recognizing that he's alive and real today. We've heard two people talk about it. Jesus is still alive. He's here in Elko, Nevada, of all places. He's here in Elko, walking these streets, visiting people's homes, reminding us that we can't do life without him. And also in this, we're reminding ourselves that he's coming again. He's coming again. Look out those windows for just a moment. He's going to split the sky one day. And we're going to see him if we live long enough. If he comes while we're here on earth, we're going to see our Lord come down just the way he rose. I don't know how all the world can see him at one time, but he's going to do that. He's coming again. So as we take the bread and the juice, we remember some things our brother said many years ago, the Apostle Paul, 1 Corinthians 11. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you. What I received from Jesus, I deliver to you. That the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So if you'll just tear off the top part, one side of that packet, a little wafer of bread. This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. We'll turn it over. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Pull back the tab. As often as you do it in remembrance of me. Father, thank you for water that is symbolic. for living testimonies of people who are alive, for bread and juice, which are also symbolic of you, Father, stepping into time and space and doing for us what we could not do for ourselves. And the grace that brought us into the family is a grace that keeps us into the family. Father, thank you for Tony and Beth's words, for the way you communicated through believers how their lives in many ways were falling apart. And then they saw you. No, actually, you saw them. And you brought them to yourself and you loved them. And then after they became new creatures in Christ, they experienced more heartache and more sorrow and disappointment and loss. And the grace that saved them was the grace that kept them and keeps them and will keep them until you return. And what's true for Beth and Tony is true for others of us today who know you as our Savior. And so Jesus, help us to keep drinking and eating at your table. This place of grace upon grace upon grace upon grace. It's not about us. It's all about you. And the more we see and experience your love, the more we dive into your unconditional love for us, the stronger we become, the more we're able to handle life's heartaches and disappointments and deep, deep pits. Father, thank you for family life. We need one another. Father, we readily admit that we easily get on each other's nerves at times. But Lord, we thank you for grace to work through our difficulties, to work through our differences, and to humbly serve one another and be stronger on the other side. So thank you for family life. Father, for those here who maybe didn't have peace about taking the bread and the juice because they don't know you as their Savior, they've not experienced anything that like Beth and Tony talked about, and they've never been baptized, they've never trusted you as their Savior, and they're not sure that if they die today that they would be wrapped in arms of love. And so, Father, I pray for those individuals that today would be a day where they could nail it down and receive from you the grace that you offer. With heads bowed and eyes closed, could you make where you sit a place of worship? Could you think upon Christ's death for you? If you're struggling, if you're angry at God today, if you're bitter and upset with others, not even sure why you're here, that you would make where you sit a place to be angry at God, to complain, to be honest, to be real. You're not going to tell him anything he doesn't already know. He knows what's in your heart today. The confusion, the fear, the depression, the anger, the bitterness over life circumstances. Could you give that to him today? Maybe today will be the first day of the rest of your life. Because you heard somebody say it's okay to be angry at God. And in a worship service, you were given the freedom to be real with God. My friend, that's how we all become Christians, is being real. Praise team is going to lead us for a couple of minutes as we meditate. And then Deanna will lead us as we close.
One love, my God, could bring you down to earth. What king would take a low and lonely birth? Yet to this dark and broken place you came, to sleep beneath the stars that you had made. Thank you.
Sunday when we receive a benevolence offering, and so if Holy Spirit puts that on your heart as you leave today, a couple of guys will have some bags to take that as well. Also, maybe Holy Spirit's spoken to you in some way. We pray that He has, that you'll feel the freedom to come, and maybe you've got a prayer request or a prayer need. Aside from the connection cards, a couple of our elders will be up here today along with me. And we would love to pray with you if that's something you sense Holy Spirit leading you to do. I'm going to ask Mike and Lynette if you guys would come and stand. And I want to be down here with you. And maybe someone want to come and love on you guys for just a couple of minutes. Mike, is there anything you want to say other than yes, like you did in the water today?
No, I think that's about it.
Okay. All right. Continue to pray for Mike and Lynette. Whenever we take steps of obedience like this, it's not a box to check, but a step to take, we have an adversary who likes to bring discouragement and despair. And And so Mike might see a couple of tough days, the next couple of days. And so pray for Mike and Lynette. And those of you who have walked this road before, you know how the enemy can sometimes do that. So maybe let's do that. Let's extend our hands to Mike and Lynette right now and pray for them as we close our service. Father, thank you for meeting us today in unique and special ways. Baptism, Lord's Supper, and testimonies. Thank you for changed lives. This is not something Daryl's manufactured or any of the elders here. You, by your Spirit, are changing lives. And it's a privilege to witness that, to see what you're doing in Mike and Lynette. Father, we pray for fresh fillings of Holy Spirit upon them this week. You would protect him from the schemes of the evil one. That he would just have a hotline to heaven this week, and maybe in a way that he's not in a long, long time. Encourage him. Build those roots. Cause them to go deep, deep into your word. Lord, as we leave this place, but never from your presence, we ask again for grace to grow deeper into you, to know your mighty, mighty love. And we ask it, Father, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Lord bless you.